Hi everybody, welcome to the performance tuning Grails applications talk. My name is Lari Hotari. I work for Pivotal. I started in the Grails team in the beginning of this year. And I thank you for coming to my talk. I appreciate your time, and I hope you find some useful tools, tips, and methods for doing performance tuning in your environments for your Grails applications. I'm going to start off with a famous quote that we all know, that premature optimization is the root of all evil. So do you believe that this is true? And I think I saw a blog post about mature optimization, and I'm going to start going that ways first. So mature optimization, it's about that you really understand your requirements. And in this case, when we're talking about performance, there are usually quality requirements of your solution. And there's many names for quality requirements, like non-functional requirements and so on. But it's really important that you dig in and find them out and keep learning about them. And it's a moving target. You'll never be able to get them stabilized. And at the same time, mature optimization, it's about keeping your solution clean, that you keep the clarity and consistency of your solution so that you don't introduce accidental complexity in your solution and make it hard to maintain. So it's really important that you don't do things just because this is faster or someone said so or someone thinks so. So I think that when this quote, Donald Knuth was writing this article in 1974, he was meaning something along these lines. So let's start doing mature performance tuning and optimization today. Let's commit to that. How do we define application performance? There are different performance aspects, and one is latency of operations. And this is usually what we developers think, that it's fast when something is very responsive and the latency is low. But it's only one aspect. There's a throughput of the operations, like how many, for example, for how many requests per second your system can handle. And very important aspect is the quality of the operations, because you're not aiming for a best of the world solution. There's always constraints that are limiting the choices you can make. We'll go later on more into those aspects, and so we'll get back to those later. When I was preparing for this talk, I really kind of started digging into the theory of performance optimization and why we do things in a certain way. And to me, there came up two laws, which is the other one is Amdahl's law and the other one is Liddell's law. And I personally found them very inspiring and in understanding that what we're actually doing and how to reason about different kind of decisions in performance optimization. And I must say that this is nothing specific to Grails performance tuning or optimization. So if you came here just to hear about Grails performance tuning, I'll give you a little bit more. So I hope you can join me in learning about these two fundamental laws, which are actually very simple, but they provide a lot of information and insight for us. So Amdahl's law, it's about speeding up a single computation, and it tells us that if we're not able to parallelize the computation task, we won't be able to get it faster. And here, this chart here explains more of the nature. And here are several lines with a different percentage of the execution that can be parallelized. In the lowest line here, it's where 50% of the computation can be executed in parallel. And when you add in this scale here, it's about number of nodes or processors or cores or whatever you want to call it in the system. And if you're not able to parallelize the task, you cannot scale it by adding more nodes to the system. So that's basically what it tells us. But when you're so for example, that when you have 60 nodes in the system, the speed up is only two times when you're able to do 50% of the computation in parallel. And in comparison to the line where it's showing the 95% the speed up is at 16, it's about nine times faster. So for example, the latency is 1/9 of the latency what it's in when there's only one node. So it's one here. So that might be a bit hard to grasp by my bad explanation of this, but I'm really excited about this graph here, and I'm sure that you'll also be when you kind of apply that. Then there's a Liddell's law, which is from queuing theory. I'm not any expert in that area. I just read about this on Wikipedia, and this is referenced in many of the performance tuning literature. But from here, we could get some insight for some things. What I'll reference is this later on in this presentation. So it's basically an equation that the mean number in the system, it's the mean throughput times mean response time. A very simple equation, but that also provides some important insight. We'll get back to that later. So this presentation, it's pretty long, and I want to make at this point a short TLDR type of conclusion of what I have here later on regarding Grails performance tuning. So I'm going to introduce here a method called Lari's Grails performance tuning method. And this method is about these type of simple kind of things to look for in Grails performance tuning. So first of all, it's always the case that we all know that SQL in the database is a bottleneck, and that hasn't changed. So that's something that you have to keep an eye on and have tools for showing that. Then a special aspect that I've concentrated on when I've done Grails core performance tuning is a thread blocking and reducing that. And that shows up in the profiler as high object. There's a mistake there. High object monitor usage. So it's very easy to get that the values for that in a profiler, and I'll be showing that later on. And then when exceptions are used in normal program flow, you should always check for that, because building the stack trace for an exception, that's relatively high costly. There are ways to prevent building a stack trace for an exception, but that's a different type of thing. But normally, you shouldn't be using exceptions in normal program flow. So they should be really reserved for exceptional usage. Then I have a short list of low-hanging fruits, and we'll go through that later on. And those are things that I've encountered myself, or I've heard like people ask me that questions about those issues in performance, Grails performance. And in almost in any kind of performance tuning, there's you kind of have to have a continuous improvement kind of cycle that you do changes, and then you measure again and learn and iterate and continuously. So that's in short form the Grail specific aspect of the performance tuning method that I've been using for several years. And so I'm mostly talking about how I've been doing things in this area, but in this presentation, since I had to fill up the 90-minute time slot, this presentation would have been pretty short, like 15 minutes, and we'd be over here. So we kind of are going back to the theory and looking more about what kind of like strategies we have available for doing performance tuning in general, and what's the recommendation for different kind of development teams for arranging that. So first of all, what are we aiming for? And what is the goal of performance tuning? So as earlier, I mentioned that the quality aspects or requirements, that's very important. So that's the primary goal that we assist in fully fulfilling the quality requirements and constraints that the system has. And when you meet your quality requirements, it makes you, the developers and ops, DevOps, makes you guys happy, makes your boss happy, makes your business owners happy, and it makes your customers happy. So why shouldn't we go that direction? And that really means that we have to concentrate on the requirements and not start making up things that we have to do this because it's cool to do that thing faster or use that kind of framework here and there. So you shouldn't be doing decisions based on that kind of basis. So more about the performance-related qualities of operations. There is, for example, efficiency, like with a certain amount of resources that you're able to use them in an efficient way, that you get most out of your hardware investments you've made and so on. Then there's availability, that your systems are available in the required level of availability. And these are usually we just list them down, and it's kind of hard to get different values or measurements to attach to these qualities, but it's still important to strive and really work hard and talk to your customers and really try hard to understand what the real requirements, the quality requirements are. Usually they are hidden, like there's certain type of expectations that when you're using a web application that it's certain kind of responsiveness, that when you click on a button that you don't have to wait, for example, over 150 milliseconds or so. But no one might kind of come up with these values to you and say that we have to have this kind of system that meets these quality requirements. So it's usually the case that if you're as a architect in a project, that you have to yourself go and gather those performance requirements and find some ways to express those. So operational efficiency is one of the key things here, that we're tuning the system to meet its quality requirements with optimal cost. So there's always a cost when we're doing different kind of decisions in your system, and usually want to optimize for minimal cost. There might be also other aspects, that if your current system is slow and previous attempts to scale it and horizontally they fail because of the lack of parallelization in your system, so that it doesn't scale up even if you do add more servers to your system. So in that case, you really have to, you're kind of forced to do the tuning even though you had the money to just buy new servers. So how do we succeed in performance tuning? I believe that continuous improvement strategy, that gives a kind of a strategy for performance tuning anything. And here's a kind of a generic build, measure, learn type of cycle applied to performance tuning. This came into my mind because I've been following the lean startup movement and this kind of experimenting and measuring and learning and then doing its iterative way. It's also in lean startup really is essential. So that's why it came to my mind that we might as well apply something similar to performance tuning so that there's a continuous improvement cycle. And I believe that this helps also your teams to build up the experience and knowledge to do performance tuning, gradually learn and improve. So you start with the tools you have available and you just start doing iterations. It doesn't mean that you're doing like 2 week or some iterations like that. You might have a plan for a day that today we're gonna do this kind of experiment and we'll find the tools for doing it, we'll learn on it and then plan the next step. So that's the type of thing I'm talking about. And when you're doing tuning, it might take like 5 minutes for you to do one iteration like this. So it's continuous improvement. You iterate, iterate, and iterate. And finally, you'll achieve excellence in performance tuning. I guarantee that. And in these feedback cycles, to succeed, you have to be sure that you also get feedback from real customers and real production environments. So it's irrelevant that your system performs well on your own laptop and you tell your boss that it was fast on my laptop. That doesn't help you. Or it doesn't help your customer at least. So if you want to be successful, you really have to get into the connection with the real customers and real production environment and the DevOps or Ops guys who are possibly a separate team that is running the operations. So many times in large corporations, you might have to be very like innovative to find ways to get into the feedback cycle, like the development team. And there might be like separate companies doing this, so it's not always an easy thing to achieve. Is there any questions at this point? I forgot to tell you that just whenever you have a question, just lift your hand up and I'll try to answer. So any questions at this point? We can then go into some derived goals from so that we look more specifically into the subject. So if your requirement is to lower latency, Amdahl's law tells us that you won't be able to effectively speed up a single computation task if you cannot parallelize it. In an ordinary synchronous blocking servlet API programming model, what Grails, like the default model for Grails is, this doesn't mean that you can't make it fast, but you have to make sure that the use of shared locks and resources is minimized in handling of requests. So this means that reducing thread blocking the object monitor usage is a key principle for improving performance in traditional Grails applications. And the ideal is to get into a lock-free request handling, even if the synchronous servlet API is used there. This is, of course, an ideal because it's never possible in full extent, but we could always try to minimize the use of shared locks and resources. And then if we apply Little's law to this Grails context, we can do some calculations and reasoning about programming models that fit the requirements and available resources. So this means that, for example, in a in-house application that has just like a couple of hundred users, there isn't a real performance, or usually there isn't a performance requirement to use a non-blocking asynchronous type of programming model. So this means that traditional servlet API thread per request model, it could fit your requirements and still, you could still be able to make it fast, like to achieve low latency in most cases. So here's something about the equation that, or what we can reason based on Amdahl's law and Little's law. Like from Little's law, the mean number in system is mean throughput times mean response time. So the reasoning we can do from this is that related to the thread per request model is that the upper bound for mean number in the system is the maximum for the number of request handling threads. So this might be limiting the throughput of your system. So when you, because it's bounded, it can't grow higher the mean number in system because of the thread per request model, even though you'd otherwise have the resources available in your system. And this might limit the throughput even farther, especially when the response time gets higher or request planning threads get blocked and hang. You could do calculations from that equation that when the problems start to pile up in your environment, like based on how many concurrent requests you have, like the mean number of requests in your system, and based on that you could do some calculations like what's the response time when it hits the limit, like on what kind of throughput. So you could kind of do the math around that and use that as a way to do simple calculations. And then there might be like shared locks and resources that might be setting the upper bound to a very low value. And usually these problems get even worse under error conditions. So there might be a upper limit that you're only able to handle like one at a time. And when the request handling for each request takes long, we all understand that it's a very limiting factor. So that's almost like common sense, like if we think of that, but then in some ways we get some ways to reason about it, and when we start thinking of in what type of applications we have to move to reactive, asynchronous, non-blocking programming models. We then know what the turning point is for us that we have to do the choice. And I'll be talking more about the like using Wrap Pack and Grails 3 in my second talk. It's more like about the ideas of using that programming model in Grails context. But the thread per request model, it certainly has some advantages, because we're used to the debugging of the thread per request model, like adding breakpoints, attaching the debugger, and going through the stack. This is something that with a synchronous style, non-blocking style, it's totally different. The debugging and the tooling is pretty like much missing in most areas, because it's such a new technology for many environments, even though the programming model is very, very old. And perhaps it's just that everyone's just used to doing programming in this type of programming model. And there's such a friction in switching to different programming models and paradigms. I personally think that the killer app for non-blocking asynchronous model is responsive streaming of a high number of clients on a single box. Like we saw last night in the technical keynote, the reactor demo, that's something that will become more common. And when you have continuously connected real-time applications where low latency and high availability is the requirement, there's really no other ways to solving that problem. When you have like limited resources, that there's some constraints there that you should be cost efficient and optimal there. So that's why it's important that in the future we'll have different ways of doing things in Grails. But at the same time, I still think that it's still compelling to use the thread per request model, because it's going to take a long time before this a change happens that we think in totally different ways. And there's also other things that it might be hard to find talented people to do things. But on the other hand, doing cool things, they attract talent. So it's not that easy to just say that it's hard to find people to do those, because it might be actually many developers like to choose jobs based on cool technologies and ways to work. So let's get back to profiling Grails applications and getting the performance tuning done. And first, about some JVM code profiler concepts that show up in when you start doing profiling. There's you could do normally profiling in two different ways, that there's sampling and then instrumentation. In instrumentation profiling, you get exact measurements of the method execution details. And that might sound very reasonable, but I've personally found that looking for exact information in profiling JVM, you shouldn't be doing that. And the sampling profiling, it in many cases it gives very good information. If you don't look at the numbers, that you kind of look at relatively compare in a single profiling session different things. So this sampling profiling, it usually gives better understanding of the real problem if you look past the numeric values. But at the same time, they're unreliable results, because you don't, it's using statistics and sampling to kind of estimate the numbers. So it's they're not accurate. But normally that doesn't matter. Yeah.
I think the numbers, the millisecond values get generated. Isn't it kind of true that it's Java's not safe for real-time applications because of the garbage cleanup and all that? You don't know when that's going to happen. So I guess what serves as sort of the metronome for counting the milliseconds that it takes to perform an operation? How do we know that value is accurate?
That is the real problem, because in the JVM, there's a JIT compiler, and then you don't. It depending on the workload, the code will take a totally different execution path, and then it doesn't really make sense to look at the numbers, and then I actually haven't checked that out, like what's the equation it uses to do the calculate the values when you're doing sampling profiling. Because in sampling profiling, if you kind of simplify, what's happening is that it's let's say like each 100 milliseconds, it does a thread dump for all the threads, and then based on those stack traces, it does the calculations. So that's simplified what sampling is, but I don't actually know the details, like how that happens. But it's a pretty surprising that you actually get useful information in that ways, because it's not changing the way it's executed so much when compared to the instrumentation. But there might be things like in different JVMs that or different tooling. I have a few slides of a new tool that could be used in in the JVM environment, and that might change some ways. But I personally don't have experience of using those methods. So usually when we do performance tuning, we have to have some tools for generating load there so that we could do the measurements. And I've found simple command line tools very effective in doing the Grails core performance tuning. And there's a tool, WRK, which is a modern HTTP benchmark tool, which is a command line tool, and it has Lua scripting support for doing things like verifying the reply or the response. And that's pretty handy even for doing like simple load testing on your own laptop. Like just hitting one or a few URLs and looking finding out what the bottlenecks are there. For real kind of a simulation of real workloads and kind of real users simulating those, there's different toolkits and service providers that you could use. For example, if you want to test your system with 50,000 concurrent users, you could pretty easily do that by using various cloud services. So that's a pretty effective way of doing such tests, and you don't have to buy hardware for doing that or do any kind of special setup. In your own environments, you could use JMeter and Gatling, for example. These are open source projects. Personally, I've used JMeter, and that you could use in a cluster mode, and you could generate pretty high load with that, even with that. Gatling is a newer tool which I haven't used myself, but it has showed up many times, like I've heard many recommendations about that tool. Is there any questions at this point? So I really already mentioned a few of these common pitfalls in profiling Grails. And that's the most common one, I think, is that measuring like wall clock time, or even measuring too strictly the CPU time for a method, because of the reasons I mentioned that there's a JIT compilation that changes things, and then if you have blocking in your code, the JVM might use spin locks that actually turn up into high CPU usage, because it's more efficient to just spin in a loop, the CPU in a loop, until it continues. So it's kind of hard to look at those CPU and wall clock time figures, and I found out much better ways and just mostly ignoring those, and instead I've used when I've done some profiling that is using the instrumentation. This is useful for finding the exact value, like how many method calls do you do with a certain workload. Because then you you could kind of find out surprises that something surprising is happening. And I'll later on mention a few examples of such surprises. Then there's many times, if you're doing micro benchmarks, you have to be sure that the JVM is properly warmed up. Now there's a really nice toolkit for doing micro benchmarks. It's called JMH. But I personally haven't experimented a lot with that. I've basically just read about it and not really used it yet. But that's something I'm planning to do and leverage that more in Grails performance tuning. But the real pitfall is that if you're lazy and don't do the measurements and you just rely on gut feeling, that's a real big mistake, because it's almost impossible to without profiling to know what the bottleneck is in a large system. So back to the link to the production environment. You should find ways to review production performance graphs regularly, especially after you make changes to or major changes to the system, so that you kind of notice that if something changes dramatically after some kind of update. For example, you update to a newer JVM version or something like that, that you kind of review the graphs and have kind of, you know what the trends are in the performance graphs. In the cloud, there's nice tools like New Relic and others to do this reviewing, that you get a insight what's going on and what the trends are. In the development environment, you should use a profiler and debugger to get understanding. And there's also some Grails profiler plugins that are kind of a different type of thing than actual Java profilers. And they're pretty handy if you want to get an insight on SQL statements and the number of operations or something like that. But for real profiling, I really recommend to use a real profiler. I personally have used YorkIt profiler a lot, but I'm quite sure that many others provide the similar features. So next to the low-hanging fruit, here I have six different kind of low-hanging fruits which you should check out, and always make sure that you don't have something like that in your system if you're looking for high performance, low latency, and high throughput with optimal cost. Some of them aren't very easy to achieve yet, but I'll talk about those when we go into those. I think the most common problem is that the out-of-the-box Tomcat parameters are not really good for running Grails applications. And with JDK 7, you usually run out of permgen after after a little while with larger applications. And I'm quite sure that most of us have experienced that at some phase of getting used to Grails. So because of that, I actually looked up some proper values for a Tomcat configuration, and so I'll give you some values you could start with, but it's something that it might vary in your environment, but then at least you have a starting point. And then one problem I've noticed that in some environments, people have been running Grails in a huge, big box with a lot of power and resources, and they have a big single JVM there, running there. And that's very inefficient usage of resources. And there's a few reasons for that, and one is that there are some blocking problems even in the JVM. And if you run a single big JVM, it's the blocking problems, they get worse. So it's better to run multiple small JVMs and put a load balancer in front of them. So that's what you should do if you're running a big box with a single Tomcat instance on it with a huge heap size. So here's an example of configuring Tomcat. And this is the way I've been doing it. There might be better ways to do this, but I kind of took this out of my notes and snippets I have. And so in Tomcat, when you create a file setenv.sh in Tomcat Home's bin directory, it'll pick that up and the variables from there. And Catalina opts is a variable where you should add the JVM options. And here I've set a few basic ones like the Java home to the JDK, and then for forcing that everything goes with UTF-8, I usually have done this, even though it's not really required, because UTF-8 encoding is also enforced with the file encoding system property over here. But that's not related to performance, so I'll show a few lines that are relevant. Like this one, here's the heap size, like the for the permgen size, like 256 megabytes. And then for a Grails application, I usually recommend, or actually we've run a lot of applications with these settings, that the minimum heap size is set to the same value as a maximum heap size. And I've usually started with 768 megabytes. And if you're low on resources, you could try lower values. At least 512 megabytes, that's been sufficient for many applications. Then there's a few, because this is a real example, what I've been using, I've also disabled IPv6 when it's not used on the box. So that's the Java property for doing that. Then setting the local settings so that in with a user.language and user.country, you could set the local settings for the JVM. If you're running in some environment that has some different settings, then you with these you could make sure that you have a certain local settings in JVM, and then same for the time zone. Then here's a Grails environment setting. I usually set it fixed in the setenv.sh so that I know that it's using the production value, and in different environments this could be changed here. Then a performance related value settings are the timeouts for the JVM URL handler. And that's a problem that has showed up at many of my previous customers, that the whole application just locks up. And that has been caused in some cases by that you just have a URL.txt, and then the server is down, or it's slow. And in that case, it brings down the whole application. So if you're using URL.txt in any ways, you should always make sure that you set some timeout limits for the sun.net.client.default connection timeout and sun.net.client.default read timeout.
Is there a default setting for that?
It's the default setting it'll wait forever, so there's no timeout by default. So that's a real bad default. And the problem is that in some environments that problem might show up like a few times a year or so, and then you never find out what caused it. The ops guys just reboot the box, and so problem is gone. But if you want to prevent that reboot, you could add these in the settings. Then there's for some reason Tomcat defaults that if you start the Tomcat in a different directory, it has its user directory set to that one where you call the script. So this one just sets it to the Tomcat directory, the user dot dir. And then there's the last setting is for setting the process ID, like the file for that. So you get that in a file. And on Tomcat also, when you have this setting, you have an option for killing the Java process with the catalana.sh script that comes with Tomcat. So it's also handy for that. Yesterday I was at a presentation about tuning large scale Java platforms. And there were two gentlemen, real professionals in this area. And from there I picked some rules for sizing the JVM heap size. That presentation was a lot it contained a lot more, but I went to that to look for recommendations for this area. And there, I heard this recommendation that set the minimum and maximum heap size to the same value to prevent compaction and full GC. So that's what I had been doing previously, but now I heard a professional tell that same tip. Then I also heard another tip for the recommendation of the heap size that you could check for example, with a profiler or a GC viewer or logging, you check the survivor space size of your when your application is active, and then the recommendation for the total heap size is something between 3 to 4 times the size of the survivor space size. And it was also mentioned that you shouldn't exceed the NUMA node's local memory size on your server configuration. And this is the NUMA architecture is something related to server hardware architecture. And on Linux, you could find out the NUMA node size with NUMA CTL hardware command. Because it's the total memory is split into two different local memory areas for different sockets and cores on the processor. And it depends on the processor type, like how it's done. So I think this NUMA CTL hardware, that command is a really good way to find out the node size. And on the presentation yesterday, they recommended that you don't exceed it, that you leave a safe margin there to the maximum size. And if you're running something else on the server, you have to prepare for that also. And possibly use certain type of tuning if it's a hardware server. So the most common problem, and that was on our low-hanging fruit, is still the SQL. So you should really be aware of what are the most common SQL statements and learn how to tune SQL if you're using a SQL database, as I assume many are. And tuning SQL, in some cases, it's real black magic, and you might benefit from the DBA guys, and that they come and do that for you. So that's an area where you have to practice it a lot to get good at tuning that. And there's, for example, on some of the cloud tools like New Relic, you could see the SQL statements from the user interfaces too. And that's the same thing goes to Profiler, for example, YorkIt. There's a way to find out the SQL statements that are executed. On my list, I had a kind of a new item that I want to pick on my list. And I haven't been very satisfied with the different cache implementations that are on the JVM. But I recently ran into this Juava's loading cache when I was working on a Wrapack pull request for adding Spring Boot support to Wrapack. And I read about this and I thought that this is so good news that I want to add it to my presentation. So this has exactly the algorithm for a cache implementation that I've been looking for. And this is really handy in busy applications, because in busy applications, it might be surprising that the caching might be causing problems, more problems to your application than it's solving. And it's not usually that case, but the caching itself, it could be more optimal. And here's explained that the algorithm that while the new value is loading, the previous value, if any, will continue to be returned by get unless it is evicted. If the new value is loaded successfully, it will replace the previous value in the cache. If an exception is thrown while refreshing, the previous value will remain and the exception will be logged and swallowed. So this is something really handy for many, many applications, and you don't run into kind of cache storm type of problems that when entries expire in the cache, that they cause blocking, that requests are waiting for the expired entry to be refreshed. Because in this implementation, it'll use the expired entry, it'll give that for the others, or so until it has asynchronously updated the timed out entry. So that's really handy, and I hope that Grails plugins could leverage this type of algorithm. Like, for example, the Grails cache should add support for this. Currently, it's not using this type of cache implementation, I believe. And here's a pretty surprising CPU hog, that with a simple regexp, you could get your CPU on the knees. And I've seen this a few times in production environments. And it's pretty hard to catch if you don't know that this exists. So at this point, I'll try to show a tool for profiling regexps. So in this tweet, I've tweeted this twice, this same thing. This is not my example. I read it somewhere else, but I thought it, because it was tweetable example, I used it. So with this regexp match on this input, it causes 84,345 operations. And when you do a slight change on the regexp, it only causes 108 operations. So that's a huge difference, especially if you have a high number of concurrent requests being handled. That sums up in a huge CPU hog in your system.
Question.
Yeah. I'm going to show that now. So let's see if I get my. So this is a free tool, JRegex Analyzer, that you could use for finding out this information. I've actually read about this problem on a website that is, the author of that website he's selling a tool called Regex Buddy. The problem is that it's Windows only, and so otherwise I would have bought that tool because it saved me that article a lot. So all the kudos to Regex Buddy's author about explaining this problem. I'll show the links to that explains it. But this tool is by I can't remember the author of this, but you'll find it on with Google, this tool. So we'll try to find the regex was like that. And it'll update the information when you type here. And here you can see on the lower left corner, it's not very visible, but here you see the six operations for that regex. Then it had something like that. Did it crash? I forgot the comma there. But now it's probably causing so many operations that it has crashed. Let's try again.
Question.
Yep.
Is this something that happens then across different regex interpreters?
Yes, that's something that happens across different implementations. And so let's try again. My laptop has finished layout, but now I use a US layout, but now when I'm trying to do it in front of the crowd, it's forget where the buttons are. Let's check it again. Yeah, there it is. And here you could. And here now I'm adding input here. With this input, it's 54 operations. Now it's 114, 234, 474, 954. 1,914, 3,800. Now let's add a few more. So now it's already 100,000 169,000 over that. So as you could, yeah, go ahead. Yes, there is. It's because it's looking for all the different combinations or what can match. And it's there's a whole article of. I'll repeat the question. I forgot to repeat that. Is there something particle in this regex that is causing it? And the answer is yes. And that's explained in the article. Let's go back to our presentation. So here's a link to the article, and he's calling it catastrophic backtracking. And here it says that the solution is simple. When nesting repetition operators make absolutely sure that there is only one way to match the same match. So you, that's something that you have to ensure. And there's various ways to find where you have regex in your applications, and you could use even the profiler to look up the number of operations on the regex classes. If it's very high, then you should do something about it. So going forward to the low-hanging fruit, this is something that has showed up a few times, is that mostly in cases where you're using a service from a tag library. And if you call transactional services from a tag library, it's initializing a new transaction scope for each call. And if there is a loop in your view rendering, and you have a lot of items, you could be like calling it like 10,000 times for a single request. And that sums up in a pretty costly, it's relatively low cost, that the cost of the transactional context, but then it sums up in certain cases like that. So that's something that you should check, that you have transactional faults in services that don't need transactions. So here comes pretty surprising information also, that the JDK has a lot of unnecessary blocking in itself, or kind of excessive blocking that shows up in many applications. And the worst is that Java util properties extends hash table, which is synchronized. So anything that's calling system.get property, it's causing blocking. And since the JVM translates, it uses internally some techniques like those spin locks and things like that to do synchronization and optimizing that. They sum up as a relatively high costly thing. I haven't tried this myself, but there is a solution for this, that it's monkey patching the JDK's hash table class with a high performance implementation. And this is on GitHub. This high scale library contains jar file which you could override the Java util hash table. The problem is that might not be up to date, because it's there hasn't been any commits on that project for a long time. But that's, if you want to get rid of that problem, that's probably the route you have to choose. Because in Grails, I had to eliminate the synchronization in PrintWriter. And the same thing, I looked in Tomcat and JBoss, and they had done a trick to instantiate the PrintWriter instances directly with the reflection. So a similar method is used in Grails also, like a tuning for that. But what I've seen in some applications, that there's kind of feature flags that are used with boolean get boolean in some feature flag, and that causes trouble if that's executed in each request handling. Then here's a few small tips that when upgrading old applications, they might not contain the configuration for setting the controller's scope to singleton. That has changed, and I can't remember exactly, was it 2.0 or 2.1 or 2.2, it was probably already 2.0 where that changed. But I've ran into some applications where this was missing from the configuration, and then it was using prototype scope, which is the default if this is missing this setting. So tools for performance tuning in production environments. There's a typo there. There's a simple inspection you could use in production environments, or at least I've been doing it. And it's this. You do a kill minus 3, and you give the process ID, and that will do a thread dump to standard output. It's a bit similar as JSTAC in giving the process ID, but the difference is that the output will go into the standard output of the server, so it ends up in Tomcat Catalina out file. And this is pretty handy because the Java process keeps running and it doesn't get terminated, and you get the information of the execution state at that point when you did the thread dump. For example, if you're running into trouble that the server is very slow, it's very probable that there is something, for example, the URL timeout problem. It shows you could easily catch it with this thread dump information. So it's a really, really handy tool in production environments. Then there's a new tool for the JVM, which is a really nice tool. Personally, I haven't really played around with it that much, and I've never used it in real production environments. And there's also a reason for that, and that's because it's something that isn't free. It comes with the JVM, but the license doesn't allow you to use it in commercial use. So you must buy a license from Oracle for each JVM using it. It's a very, very nice tool, and you get insight in with really low overhead. So that's a nice tool, but it's a shame that it's a pretty expensive tool. So there's just one slide about how to use that and control that, but there's much more if you Google about that. So I'm gonna show a short demo of doing some performance testing. And when you're doing Grails testing, you should always use a run var command to start it up, because in the development mode, it's really slow, because there's none of the optimizations there. In this example, this is also, I'm sorry. I forgot to mirror the screen. So that's where I started up, and now it's running, and here, let's see what, it's a correct version. And in this directory, I have for example, starting the application, I had a simple script like that. So it's running with a prod run var. So it's using the production environment and using a run var command to run the Grails application. And then for doing the performance test, I have a simple script that has a loop, and then it calls this WRK to do the tuning. And let's do that to see what's going on. So now it's running the test with 10 threads and 10 connections for 10 seconds at a time, and then it's doing the reporting. And we'll have to make that font size a little bit smaller. So now we can see the values here. So this is a simple Grails application with an empty controller, which just renders the action URI to the output. And it's Grails performs surprisingly well, like considering the high, relatively high cost of overhead of the framework. But in this case, on my laptop, it's 24,000 requests per second. And here's a couple of values to look at in, like, the latency, the standard deviation of the latency, and then the maximum. Like, the average is only like 3 milliseconds for each request. And then I think this tells that 96% of the requests are within the standard deviation range there. So this tells that it's very stable, like the request handling, it doesn't vary too much. And here is also another way to get insight to the distribution, that there's a 70, like the 50% line is the slowest request there is, or 50% of the requests are faster than 377 microseconds. So using these values, you could kind of see how it behaves. And now I'll stop that test. So there was a slide about some notes about this view here, like checking the latency and maximum distribution and looking at those values. And here's a link to the GitHub page where you could find this application. There's scripts also for performance tuning. So any questions? Okay, thanks. Thank you for coming.